Bibliophiles of the internet, welcome to a super chill, low stakes reading vlog. I'm just gonna show you what I'm reading this week. It just feels like a good time to start a vlog because I finished two books over the weekend. I started a new one yesterday, which was Sunday. I usually read two books at once though. It doesn't always work out. It doesn't always work to my favor, but that's just usually what I do. So I'm also looking for what else I should start next. So just to start us off, I'll tell you what I'm currently reading and also the one or two titles I'm considering for my second book. The book I started yesterday and actually got a pretty good chunk of the way through is The Partner Plot by Christina Forrest. This is her second adult romance. It is the unofficial sequel or companion to The Neighbor Favor, even though they are both standalone novels, so you don't have to read them in order or together or anything like that. I should say that I did read The Neighbor Favor last year and I really enjoyed it, and also this finished copy was very kindly sent to me by Berkeley Romance. So anyways, what's happening in The Partner Plot? It's basically a very convoluted setup for what's essentially a mixture of fake dating slash marriage of convenience. The story's following Violet Green, who's this super successful celebrity stylist. She has this amazing clientele list. She's super successful, all that kind of stuff. But her personal life is kind of in shambles because she had a very public breakup with her ex-fiance, like right before they were gonna get married. Our other main character is Xavier Wright, who was Violet's high school sweetheart. They thought they were gonna get married, have the happily ever after, all that kind of stuff, but it did not work out. And he also had these really big dreams of being a professional basketball player that also didn't work out because he got injured and had to take a different career path. And now he's working as a teacher in their hometown. But the two of them coincidentally cross paths in Vegas. So they meet up, they start talking, they feel very nostalgic. They have this one reckless night together and wake up the next day with rings on their fingers. As the haze is slowly clearing away and they're starting to come to their senses, they realize that a marriage would actually be beneficial for both of them in their respective careers. Don't ask me how. That's just what the story says. So basically they're gonna lean in and pretend to be married to each other and then obviously fall in love for real. We know how this goes. I am enjoying it so far. It's really fun. I love a good second chance romance, so I'm 100% down for that. It is taking a while for like the setup to solidify. Like it's overly complicated for reasons that it doesn't actually need to be complicated, like just for plot reasons, I guess. So I'm still kind of waiting for something significant to happen. As you can see, I am 120 pages in and I don't have any sticky notes. I don't have any annotations in this, which is very unusual for me. That really just means that, like, on a line level, there's nothing really exciting or interesting or especially emotional happening that I would want to take note of. That doesn't mean the writing itself is bad or not doing what it's supposed to do, but I am keeping that in the back of my mind. So that is my physical book for the moment, and I'll keep you posted, of course. Like I said, I usually have two books going at once if I can, and that keeps my brain happy because I usually have them in two different mediums. So like a physical book and an ebook, a physical book and an audiobook and an ebook, etc., etc. So I'm looking for either an audiobook or an ebook, and I think I have it boiled down to two choices. I'm gonna hold up the physical book, but this is actually my audiobook option potentially, and that is The Space Between Worlds by Micaiah Johnson. I have been wanting to and trying to read this book for so many years. I want to read it so badly, and this actual copy was sent to me from one of my good friends, Starla. They sent it to me many years ago as part of a top surgery recovery care package. It's almost, what, 3 years later, and I still haven't read it. From what I remember, this is a sci-fi sort of multiverse story. I'm pretty sure it's queer as well. And in this world, the ability to travel between multiverses is possible, but there's a catch because you can't travel to another multiverse where a version of yourself still exists. Our main character is kind of in a unique position because her parallel selves are very good at dying for some reason, so she is actually able to travel to a lot of different multiverses. That is, until one of her 8 remaining doppelgangers dies under very mysterious circumstances, and she's thrust into a world of secrets. That's literally everything I know about this off the top of my head, and I've just heard amazing things about it across the board. It's gotten so many incredibly good reviews. So I will do a little taste test of the audiobook, or or even the ebook later today at some point. My second option is an ebook. I have it on my e-reader right here, and that is The Dead Cattail Assassins by Pietajelly Clark. The copy I have is obviously an ARC. It comes out later this year, August 2024, and it's basically pitched as a high fantasy full of ancient gods and assassins that also has John Wick vibes. And if you know anything about me, I love John Wick. So I will be the judge of whether the John Wick vibes are there. From what I know, without actually having read it, it's about a main character named Aveen, who's nicknamed the Eviscerator, and she belongs to this very prestigious order of assassins, and of course, this order of assassins has very strict rules. Every contract they take on must be just, they can't kill anyone who's not officially one of their marks, and they must fulfill every contract they take on. If they can't complete a contract, they will be killed themselves. This book is actually my February Patreon pick. My patrons voted for me to read it and review it this month. So that's another reason why I want to kind of get a jump on it at the beginning / middle of the month so that I don't leave it to the end. I'm actually working right now, but once I take a lunch break or have some other free time, I will do a taste test of those two books, like I said, and let you know which one I decide to continue on with. So those are all the things. That's where we're starting from in this vlog. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you stick around, and I will check in with you later. Hello, it's the next day, and I have updates. First of all, last night I got to page 208 in the partner plot. As you can see, I now have two annotations, so very exciting stuff. Like I said yesterday, this is really fun and enjoyable so far. I will say that I feel like it's finally beginning to click for me at this point in the story. The one thing I will say about this author's adult romances is that there tends to be a lot of setup, a lot of complication before we get to the actual premise or even hook of the story that we're promised in the dust jacket copy. But eventually, when we do get to what the story is actually about, then it all clicks and it finally makes sense. Which is not to say that this didn't make sense to me before this point. It's a very simple, straightforward adult romance. I think what I'm referring to here is that I can finally see who the characters are and what they're going through. I can see and understand the external pressures and issues that they're both dealing with and how those things factor into and bleed into their romance. Both of them really struggle with giving themselves credit for who they are, who they become, where they are currently in life, all of their successes. It's hard for them to even label their accomplishments as successes sometimes. I'm really interested to see where Xavier's plotline is gonna go, because I think it's especially compelling because he's in this weird place where he's trying to figure out what his next move should be, what his new dream should be. He wants to achieve something else for himself beyond what he already has. And I think there's definitely a lesson to be learned there about what it means to look ahead and want more for yourself without devaluing what you have and who you have in your life. Because that's the thing with dreams. There's an implication that what you have and who you have in your life is not enough for you in some way, because you have to move on to the next big thing, the next big dream. Plot-wise, we're definitely in the thick of it now with this fake marriage, this forced proximity, all that sort of second chance romance goodness that I signed up for, so I'm very excited to see where that goes. I do have one quick task to do right now, but other than that, I don't really have anything to do for the rest of the day now that I'm done with work, so there is a chance that theoretically, I could just sit on the couch and knock the rest of this out. We'll see what happens. As far as the taste test goes for The Space Between Worlds and The Dead Cattails Assassins, I did sample both of them yesterday as promised, and I think I've made a choice. So I did sample the audiobook for The Space Between Worlds yesterday during work. I was doing some multitasking, listening to my audiobook, doing some spreadsheet stuff, and I really enjoy the narrator for that audiobook. I think they're incredibly personable and dynamic. I think they do a great job of drawing you into the story. So no matter what, when I listen to The Space Between Worlds, I will absolutely be doing the audiobook. But I think for this week, I'm going to continue with The Dead Cattail Assassins, because I read the first chapter of the book and I have to know what happens next. It was a really great opener to the story. I feel like other fantasy authors could read that first chapter and take a page out of Peter Jelly Clark's book, no pun intended, to really see what he's accomplishing there. Incredible, seamless world building in that first chapter, really interesting world building as well, establishing a lot about this sort of magic system and the characters. The narration is also really voicey, which I wasn't expecting, but I love that about it. And the main character, the narrator, Aveen, kind of gives off Gideon vibes. When I say Gideon vibes, I mean Gideon the Ninth, in case that wasn't clear. She's this badass undead assassin who has this devil-may-care attitude. She's funny, she's interesting. So I think her voice and the strength of her voice is also a big factor into why I feel like I should absolutely be continuing on with that book. And the ending of the first chapter is also buck wild. Like, the amount of tension that's able to build in the last five or so pages of that first chapter kind of blows my mind. Like I said, I'm only one chapter into The Dead Cat Tail Assassin, so I have no other thoughts to share. Those were all of my thoughts for the moment. I have nothing else to give. But for the moment, I'm going to focus on the partner plot, see if I can finish this tonight, and we'll see what happens. Hey babes, just got off work. Happy Valentine's Day, by the way. For me filming this, not necessarily for you watching this, but happy Valentine's Day all the same. First of all, I followed through. I did in fact power through the partner plot. I have officially finished. What can I say about this book? I did enjoy it, and I think it was fine overall. I always feel so bad when I call a book fine or say a book is good because it feels like I'm being petty or I'm holding back, but like I'm being very sincere. This was a good, solid adult romance. It got across the finish line. It did what it set out to do. It's a straight down the middle, straight over the plate, straight up and down, second chance romance. Do I think it's super special or meaningful or life-changing? Not necessarily for me. Am I going to remember it like a month or 2 months from now? Most likely not, but it was a good time. I enjoyed myself as I read through it, and it was a fairly successful romance. I do really respect what this story is doing thematically, which I kind of touched on yesterday, so I'm not going to recap that again. But also, I do appreciate how this story takes a modern look at what a marriage of convenience can be and sort of makes it refreshing and also kind of defangs that term, if that makes sense. When I think of a marriage of convenience, I think of how it most often came from this place of women marrying people who they were not necessarily affectionate towards or in love with because that marriage offered them some kind of conventional safety or resources, whether that's financial safety, societal safety, etc., etc. And even though now we mostly talk about it as a romantic trope, it does kind of have heavy implications because you literally, legally would have had to tie yourself to someone to gain certain advantages. I don't want to spoil how the story is sort of playing with that trope or convention, but I do appreciate how it's kind of lessening the intensity of that dynamic and putting less legal stakes and social stakes in place, if that makes sense. It probably doesn't because I'm not giving you anything, but I'm trying my best. I think the reason why this romance didn't especially blow me away is that it feels weirdly underdeveloped, which is strange because I feel like I know the characters and what they're struggling with incredibly well, but when they actually got together, when the romance kind of reaches a boiling point, I just felt like they were going through the motions and it didn't really impact me on an emotional level. Which is not to say that I don't enjoy their romantic arc or where they end up as a couple and as individuals, but just that it lacked that oomph for me in a way that I can't really explain. So I had a good time with it overall. Like I said, it's not incredibly memorable for me, so I think I would just give it a solid 3 stars. If I'm remembering correctly, I read about 172-ish pages of this to finish it yesterday, so this was absolutely my main focus. I only got to read one more chapter of The Dead Cat Tail Assassins, so haven't made much progress there, but today is the day. And I don't mean I'm gonna power through it by any means, but now I have some more time I can dedicate to it and we'll just see how far I get. I don't have too much more to say about The Dead Cat Tail Assassins, but I am still thoroughly enjoying it so far. The end of chapter 2 had another absolutely bonkers plot twist at the end, which is wild because the first chapter had an incredible cliffhanger ending, even though it's not really a cliffhanger because you're going into the next chapter, but you know what I mean. So I'm gonna see how far I can get with that one today, and I will keep you posted, of course. I don't know if I'm gonna start something else. I have an audiobook checked out for my library, but I don't really wanna get into what that is because it's something that I have to read for business reasons, shall we say. So I could theoretically start that tomorrow, maybe do some multitasking while I'm at work, but we'll see what happens. My main goal for this week was just to get through the partner plot and start something else, which turned out to be the Dead Cat Tales Assassins, which I have done. So anything else you hear me talking about during this vlog is simply a bonus. So yeah, my Valentine's Day is gonna be full of assassins, which is exactly how I like it. Oh, that reminds me, I did wanna say that the John Wick vibes are kind of there. Only two chapters in, but the second chapter was very action-packed. It did kind of give off that same John Wick sort of vibe because Aveen fought her way through like an army of people in just like the most badass way. So we'll see if the story continues to hold that line. But yeah, those are the Valentine's Day vibes. I hope you enjoyed whatever this is, and I'll see you tomorrow. Hello again, friends. It's Thursday. We're back in the office. I just got done with work, and it's probably gonna be a shorter update today because I don't have too much to add at the moment. So yesterday I did start that business-related audiobook I alluded to, and I got like halfway through it on the first sitting, which I did not expect. It's much shorter than I thought it was, and also the audiobook and the story itself are much more engaging than I thought it would be, which is all good stuff. This is the physical copy. As you can see, it's going well. I listened to more of it during work, so thereabouts is where I am at the moment. Not trying to talk too much about this at the moment because I'm trying to keep church and state separate as much as possible, if that makes sense. But I did still, of course, make time to read the Dead Cat Tale Assassins just because I've been enjoying it so much. I haven't talked about the proper synopsis for the story in a minute, so I'm just gonna circle back to that real quick. Basically, as I said before, it's a high fantasy story about a character named Aveen, who is an undead assassin. When she was resurrected, she basically woke up already having the skills that she would need to be a highly trained, highly lethal assassin, but she also has no memories of her past, so she remembers nothing about her former self or her former life. Then, of course, like I said, this guild of assassins has these very strict rules about the contracts they take on, and so when Aveen goes to carry out her latest contract, she finds that something strange is happening with her intended mark. I mentioned it before, but I've been pleasantly surprised by how voicey the narration is. Aveen's voice and her personality is very present on the page. She's strong-willed, she has this devil-may-care attitude, she takes nothing seriously, she's always making these crass or inappropriate jokes or quips, and it's just so much fun to read from her perspective. And I think the strength of her personality is really working in the story's favor because there's a lot of wild and serious and kind of mind-bending things going on outside of her that her voice and her self-assuredness really ground the story. And also there's this really interesting sort of timey-wimey mystery built into the story that I'm very curious about. I don't think I've said this in previous days, but I think this may be my first ever Peter Jelly Clark, which is wild to me because I have so many of his books and so many of his books are on my TBR, so I don't know what happened there. But again, just a little under halfway through, and I can tell you that it certainly will not be my last. Now, I do have a list graphic, like an edit that I wanted to make for posting theoretically tomorrow that I completely forgot about until today. So I might experiment with that, try to whip something up real quick. We'll see what happens. I don't know how long that's gonna take me, but once I'm done with that, then I will be able to read as much as I can. So wish me luck. Hello, it's time for a Friday update, and it will be perhaps the most unsatisfying update there can be, but it is what it is. We don't always get what we want in life. Ooh, first of all, I should say that I did actually complete that graphic I mentioned yesterday. I will insert a little picture of it here. Love how it came out, exactly the vibe I was going for. Chef's kiss. So if you're on Instagram, you can check that out. I say this update might be unsatisfying for a couple of reasons. First, really did not read anything between yesterday and today. Yesterday, I was just dead tired. I don't know what it was. And by the time I finally got some time to read at the end of the day, I just zonked out in seconds. And I don't feel bad about that because it was a really good sleep and I needed the rest. Wait, am I lying? Because I did technically finish the audiobook for that business related book that I was reading that I can't talk about yet at this particular moment. And yes, I do continue to feel like the silliest of geese referring to it that way, but that's the best I have. So I did finish that yesterday and it was really good. I enjoyed it very much. But as far as the Dead Cattail Assassins, no significant progress. I think I made it maybe half a chapter further than I was. I believe I am mid chapter 5 at this point. And before you get on your high horse, the entire book is 9 chapters total. So you can save your judgment for someone else. The other reason why I say this update might be a little bit unsatisfying is because I think I'm going to conclude the vlog here. And I know it kind of sucks not to have my full complete thoughts on everything I started this week. But again, that was never my intention when I set out to do this vlog. I did not start this with the intent of finishing X amount of books within a certain time period. I just wanted to show you, hey, here's what I'm reading this week. Another factor in that is that we are headed into a holiday weekend here in the US, so I do get a 3-day weekend off of work, and I don't want to be filming vlog updates over the weekend. I just want to edit this together tomorrow, put it together for you, be done with it, and enjoy the rest of my time off. As a quick bonus though, we can talk about some weekend reading plans. So going into the weekend, my main priority is going to continue to be that I would love to finish the Dead Cattail Assassins. As I've said before, it's a pretty short book, so I feel reasonably confident that I can finish it today if I'm feeling ambitious, or tomorrow if I'm feeling not so ambitious. So that is main priority number one. If I finish that, I also have the audiobook for All the Fighting Parts by Hannah V. Sawyer. It's a 4-hour audiobook, so I could ostensibly finish that over the weekend if I have time. And yes, I took the dust jacket off already because I thought I would be able to start the audiobook today during work. Didn't happen, but I still have it right here, ready to go. And lastly, I would love to start, if not also finish, On Air with Zoe Washington by Janae Marks. Janae Marks is one of my favorite authors. I love her book so much. This is the sequel to From the Desk of Zoe Washington, one of my all-time favorite middle grade books. And I don't know if it's a series or a duology. Frankly, I will read as many Zoe Washington books as she publishes. So these two books plus the Dead Cattail Assassins are my big reading plans for the holiday weekend. Wish me luck because I will certainly need it. I think I'm gonna call it there. This is the official end of the vlog. Thank you so much for watching. I have no idea what this is gonna turn out to be, so if you're still watching at this point, I really appreciate you. Let me know what you're reading down below in the comments. I'd love to hear all about it, and I will see you next time. Bye!